Welcome back to this next video, and this is the part two on the campylobacteriosis, which is caused by the Campylobacter jejuni. If I give you a recap of the previous video, in the previous video I told you about the foodborne diseases, and the foodborne diseases can be caused by the food poisoning or the food infection. Then I told you that which kind of the bacteria they are responsible for the foodborne illnesses. So there are thousands of types of bacteria which are naturally present in our environment, but not all of the bacteria they cause diseases in human. Now the bacteria that can cause disease in humans or in other living organisms, they are called as the pathogens. And the these pathogens which are causing the foodborne illnesses are majorly found in the food which are rich in the proteins like the meat or the poultry. Then how the bacteria get into our food, I've told you that the bacteria may be present on the products when you purchase them. So they may be present on the raw product, they may be contaminated by the animal feces, or they may be contaminated by the poor personal hygiene of the person which are handling the food. And then I told you about the danger zone, that bacteria, they can contaminate food while the storage, and they best multiply between the 50 and 140 degree Fahrenheit, that is between 10 and 60 degrees. So you have to keep the food below 10 degrees centigrade or above the 60 degrees centigrade so that you can stop the multiplication of the bacteria. Then I told you about the common pathogens as reported by the Center for Disease Control and Prevention. And then we talk about the campylobacteriosis and some of the important biochemical antibiotic properties of the Campylobacter jejuni. I told you that Campylobacter is a helical shaped non-spore forming gram negative bacteria. This is micro aerophilic in nature, and it have amphitrichous flagella. They are oxidase positive, and they grow optimally at 37 to 42 degrees centigrade. And the Campylobacter selective agar, that is actually a selective media for the isolation of C. jejuni from other bacteria. Then we talked about the virulence factor, and we discussed about the two outer membrane proteins that were the CADF, and the other one was the FLPA, and both of them they were binding to the fibronectin, and they were actually remodeling the cytoskeleton. Now, another important virulence factor that is present in the Campylobacter jejuni, that is the JlpA. And this JlpA gene that encode a JlpA protein, which is 372 amino acid residues in, and it have a molecular weight of 42.3 kilodalton. Now JlpA, it is a lipoprotein adhesion virulence factor, and it is responsible for mediating adherence to the bacterium, adherence of the bacterium to the epithelial cells. Now, more recently, it has been demonstrated that the JlpA, it is a glycoprotein in nature, and it is immunogenic during human infection. What I mean by this immunogenic is that immunity is raised against this particular JlpA protein. Now, what this JlpA do is that it interacts with the cell surface heat shock protein on the epithelial cells of the intestine. And when they interact with the heat shock protein 90 alpha, they are actually responsible for initiating the signaling pathway that leads to the activation of NF-kappa B. And this is NF-kappa B, it is one of the important component in causing an inflammatory response. So the inflammatory response that we see in the campylobacteriosis, that is actually because of the activation of the NF-kappa B. Now the Campylobacter jejuni is also known to produce glycans by the lipo-oligosaccharide glycans, and also the glycoproteins. And these glycans, the LOS and the glycoprotein, they can potentially be involved in interaction with the lectin-like host cell receptors which are present on the epithelial cell. Now, another cell surface structure of the Campylobacter that may influence bacterial interaction with the host cell is a capsular polysaccharide. But the function of this capsular polysaccharide is not yet confirmed. If you remember, I talked to you when we were discussing about the bacterial pharyngitis, I've told you that the Streptococcus pyogenes that actually use the capsule to avoid the phagocytosis. So this capsular polysaccharide that is present in the Campylobacter jejuni, that may be influencing the attachment of the bacteria with the host cell, but its function is not yet confirmed. Now, when the bacteria attaches to the cell and it invades the cells, what it do is that it is going to produce toxins, and the only interior toxin that seem to be encoded in the Campylobacter jejuni genome, that is the cytolethal distending toxin. Now, why it is called is the cytolethal, because of this particular toxin, the cell usually die. And if you look at this term distending, you will see that in a while, that when the cytolethal distending toxin it enter into the cell, that is actually making the shape of the cell in a distended structure. Therefore, they are known as the cytolethal distending toxin. However, the role of the CDT in the pathogenesis of C. jejuni dialer disease is not well understood, that how it is actually responsible for causing the diarrhea. But one of the important thing that the CDT do is that it is believed that CDT initiate DNA degradation, which causes cells to arrest in the G2 stage of the cell cycle and subsequently die by the apoptosis. Now, what happens is when there is a damage to the DNA, the P protein, what they usually do is they halt the cell cycle and they initiate the DNA repair mechanism. If the DNA is repaired, the cell cycle resumes. But if the DNA damage is not repairable, then the cell go towards the apoptosis. So in case of the CDT2, when the DNA degradation starts, their DNA degradation is usually not repairable. So those particular cell, they die by the apoptosis and they are removed. Now, it has been hypothesized that this particularly occurs in the crypt structure of the intestine, where cells are normally rapidly dividing. So when you talk about the intestine and the epithelial cells, they are very rapidly dividing, and if they are dying, what the death of the specialized cell, that is thought to lead to the loss of function and erosion of the protective intestinal epithelial layer, thus producing the electrolyte disturbances as malabsorption with diarrhea. If you talk about the absorption of the food or the absorption of the electrolytes in the intestine, the epithelial cells, they have the villi, they have got the microvilli, and they are actually responsible for absorption of the food. But if these epithelial cells, they die out because of the CDT by the process of the apoptosis, that means that the absorbing cells, they have been removed, they have been lost. Excuse me. And if the absorbing cells, that is the epithelial cell, if they are lost, that means that there will be electrolyte disturbances and there will be malabsorption of the food, and that food actually leaves the body in the form of the diarrhea. Now, the cell death that accompanies this toxin is actually the reason for the blood in the host diarrhea, or which is known as the bloody diarrhea. So the CDT is going for the death of the epithelial cell, thereby affecting the absorption of the food. Therefore, this is diarrhea, and there is also blood in the diarrhea. Now, if you talk about this CDT operon, this CDT operon actually have got three genes. One is known as the CDTA, the other one is B, and then you have got the CDTC. Now, the CDTA and the CDTC, the A and the C, they are actually responsible for binding to these epithelial cells. This hand is actually showing that these two proteins, the C and the A, they are responsible for binding to the epithelial cells. And this CDTB, that actually have got the DNA degradation potential, therefore it is going to degrade the DNA, and the scissor is actually showing the DNA's activity of the CDTB in the CDT operon. So the A and C, they are responsible for attaching to the DNA, and this B is actually going for the degradation of the DNA, thereby causing the apoptosis. Now, recent researches, they have also acknowledged that C. jejuni had developed quorum sensing phenomena, and in the quorum sensing phenomena, they are using chemical factors as a communication tool, and they are usually using these chemical factors to signal other bacterial species to coordinate the infection. So this is another important virulence factor, the quorum sensing, which actually helped establish the Campylobacter jejuni infection. Now, the C. jejuni that also have the ability to form biofilms, which are monospecies, or it can be mixed species, bacterial communities, which are encased in a matrix and they attach to the surface. In this particular case, the epithelial cells. Now, it is a well-established fact that when the bacteria, they form the biofilms, these biofilms are much resistant as compared to the isolated colonies of the bacteria. So, the low oxygen and temperature requirement, the low oxygen requirements and the temperature requirements that promote the C. jejuni growth, that is actually achieved by making these biofilms. And these biofilms have been proposed to promote the survival outside the avian host. And these avian hosts, they are actually the normal host for the C. jejuni. So when they can actually survive the these particular harsh condition that is outside their host, so they can actually survive in the meat production facilities or on the surface during transmission from one human to another human. So this biofilm formation ability of the C. jejuni is giving optimum environment for the bacteria to survive, and this biofilm formation, it also helps the bacteria to resist the action of the antibiotics. Now, the helical shape of the C. jejuni cell body and its amphitrichous flagella, they are postulated to contribute to the natural high velocity of motility observed in the vicious environment. Now, if you talk about the intestinal epithelial cells, they have got these mucus layers, and these mucus layers, they are actually a hindrance for the attachment of the C. jejuni. But the C. jejuni, it is utilizing its amphitrichous flagella to avoid, colonize, spread, and have a retention phenomena within the mucus layers of the intestinal epithelium for commensalism in animals, like their normal host, and pathogenesis of diarrheal diseases in humans. So the amphitrichous flagella, they're actually helping the C. jejuni to attach to intestinal epithelium in the presence of the mucus layer because of their motility nature. Now, when we talk about the flagellum of the C. jejuni, it is composed of 7 protofilaments, and these protofilaments consist of FLA capital A subunit and the FLA capital B subunit. So this A and B subunit, they are actually making the flagellum, and when the FLA and B subunit, they combine with each other, they actually make this big protein, which is known as the flagellin, which is actually the major protein in the flagella. Now, this flagellin protein, that is a heavily glycosylated protein. And if you look at the tip of this flagella, so the flagella is capped at a distal end by the flagellar cap protein, which is termed as the FLID, or that is also known as the HAP2. Now, the flagellar fiber that is anchored via a short hook filament structure to the flagellar motor complex in the bacterial membrane. What this means is that the flagella that is attached to the bacterial membrane, the flagella is made up of this major protein, the flagellin, and this flagellin is made up of the this capital A and the capital B subunit, and the tip of this flagellin or the flagella that is actually made by this D, and this whole complex is attached to the bacterial membrane. Now, this nanomachine, this flagella, it drives the rotation of the flagella, enabling movement of the bacteria. Now, beside its role in the bacterial motility, the flagellar apparatus that may act as secretion machinery that exposes proteins into the host cells. When you talk about this flagella, when it invades the epithelial cell, it is actually providing a route for the entry of the secretory protein like the CDT toxin. The CDT toxin, it enters into the host cell by this particular secretion mechanism of the flagella. So on one side, the flagella, this nano machine, is actually responsible for the movement of the Campylobacter jejuni, and at the same side, and at the same time, it is acting as a secretion machinery for the export of protein into the host cell cytosol. So when the CDT it enters into the host cell cytosol, it is then actually responsible for the DNA degradation and apoptosis. Now the flagellar apparatus that expose protein, which are collectively called as the Campylobacter invasion antigens, which modulates the host cell biology. And one of the important member of this Campylobacter invasion antigen is the CDT that we just discussed. Now how the proteins that are secreted by the flagellar apparatus of the jejuni are delivered into the host cell, it's still unresolved. But it has been postulated that the flagella, it can actually be utilized for the export of the Campylobacter invasion antigen into the host cell, where it modulates the host biology. Now, one of the important factors that the flagella of the Campylobacter jejuni have is that it lacks the TLR5 binding site. Now, this TLR5 binding site is known to recognize the bacterial flagellin from invading mobile bacteria. So, this particular receptor is actually a binding site for the immune cell, for the T cells, to bind to the bacteria. So, if the flagella of the Campylobacter is lacking this TLR5 binding site, what this means is that the immune system of the humans, that will not be able to recognize the flagella of this particular bacteria. Now, this flagella, it is also used, as I've told you, in the movement of the bacteria. So the bile and the L-fucose, they are actually the positive chemotaxin for the C. jejuni. And this bile and the L-fucose, it is very rich in the intestine of the humans. It means that C. jejuni can utilize the bile and the L-fucose as a positive chemotoxin, and it will utilize its flagella to move towards the epithelial cells of the intestine. Now the motility and the chemotaxis, this positive chemotaxis, it helps lead the bacteria to its colonization site, that is the epithelial cells of the intestine. Now, it has been found that the motility is a necessary component for the bacteria to be virulent, and because of this motility, it is actually reaching its colonization site, that is the intestine, where it, with the help of the flagella, introduced the virulence factor, the CDT, thereby causing the diarrhea. Now, if you talk about the sources of the route of transmission of the Campylobacter jejuni, so the sources can be all types of the poultry and the wild birds. The sources can be contaminated drinking water and unpasteurized milk. Contaminated food is also a major source of isolated infection, with incorrectly prepared meat and poultry as the primary source of the bacteria. Raw milk, again, is another important source. And the raw milk is the bacteria often carried by the healthy cattle. So the healthy cattle, they may be having this Campylobacter jejuni, which can enter into the milk. And if that milk is not pasteurized or boiled, it means that the raw milk can be a source of the Campylobacter jejuni infection. Unchlorinated water is another important source of the Campylobacter jejuni. However, properly cooking chicken, pasteurizing milk, and chlorinating water, that can kill the bacteria, and you can actually stop the infection of the campylobacteriosis. Now, Campylobacter is not, in contrast to the Salmonella, transmitted vertically, and therefore humans do not get infected by consuming eggs. Now, the route of transmission is mostly a fecal-oral ingestion of the contaminated food and water. The symptoms of the Campylobacter jejuni, there might be a mild to severe diarrhea. There can be a bloody diarrhea, and we just discussed why the bloody diarrhea is there. There can be stomach pain, there can be cramps in the abdomen, nausea or vomiting, fever, there can be headache, and there can be muscular pain. If you talk about the diagnosis, the important diagnostic test, the rectal swabs, they are directly inoculated on this Campylobacter selective agar and incubated at 42 degrees centigrade for 48 to 72 hours. So is this particular media is selective for the Campylobacter. So if there is growth, that means there is infection. And if there is no growth, that means there is no infection of the Campylobacter jejuni. You can also go for the blood glucose, the blood analysis, and when you go for the analysis of the blood, there may be a low level of the glucose, which can cause hyperglycemia, and this low glucose level can be attributed because the food is not properly absorbed by the epithelial cell of the intestine, as they have been damaged by the Campylobacter jejuni. There can be high concentration of the creatinine and sodium in the blood, and that is because of the dehydration. If you talk about the treatment, the important thing is that you should go for the liquid and electrolyte replacement, because in the healthy individual which have a competent immune system, they usually do not require any medication, and the liquid and the electrolyte replacement is enough for treating this particular condition, because it is self-healing. But if the person shows symptoms for a longer period of time, like a day or two, the azithromycin therapy, that would be a primary antibiotic choice for the Campylobacter jejuni infection, with a typical dose of 500 milligram per day for 3 days. Erythromycin is also a classic antibiotic for choice. Its resistance remains low, and it can be used in pregnant women and children. Now, as you know that in the current era, antibiotic resistance is one of the major phenomena. So what the doctor do, or what the physician do, that they go for the antibiotic sensitivity pattern as well, so that they can know what kind of the antibiotic that best treat this kind of the infection. Now, if you talk about the complications, usually the Campylobacter jejuni infection is not having much complications, but in severe cases, there can be severe complications of the Campylobacter jejuni infection. One of the important complications that is known is the reactive arthritis. And this reactive arthritis is a condition that causes redness and swelling, inflammation in various joints in the body, especially the knee, the feet, the toes, the hips, and the ankles. And it usually develops after you had an infection of the food poisoning by the Campylobacter jejuni. Now, what happens is that when the Campylobacter jejuni, it enters into your body, the immune system is going to make antibodies against it. And now, what these antibodies do is that they mistakenly attack some of the proteins that are present in the bone. And when these antibodies, they attack these proteins in the bone, this is actually responsible for the inflammation that you see in the reactive arthritis. So the antibodies, they on one side are attacking the Campylobacter jejuni, but as the structures of these proteins on the bone, they are very much similar. So these antibodies, they do react with these proteins on the bone, thereby causing inflammation. So the body immune system seems to overreact to the infection and start attacking the healthy tissues, causing it to become inflamed. Now, one of the important thing is that people who have a gene called HLA-B27, the human leukocyte antigen B27, so those particular individuals who are positive for this particular gene, they are much more likely to develop reactive arthritis than those who won't. Now, why this HLA-B27 positive, they are much more likely to develop the reactive arthritis, is not yet clear. But it is clear that those particular individuals which are HLA-B27 positive, they are having a greater than average risk for developing or having a certain autoimmune disorders. Another important complication that is known is the Guillain-Barre syndrome. This is the Guillain-Barre syndrome. Now, in this particular case, in this particular syndrome, this is a rare disorder in which your body immune system that attack your nerves. And when they attack your nerve, there is weakness in your extremities. That is the weakness in the extremities, like the feet. That is usually the first symptoms. Now, this sensation can quickly spread, eventually paralyzing your whole body within weeks. Now, why the body immune system, they attack your neurons, then your nerves, and how they are attacking it. Now, an important factor in contracting the Guillain-Barre syndrome is that this particular pathogen, the Campylobacter jejuni, that is having the sialic acid in its core oligosaccharide. If you talk about the composition of this core oligosaccharide of the Campylobacter jejuni, they have this sialic acid. Now, this sialic acid, it compares to a structure in the neuron which is known as the gangliocyte. So the sialic acid and the gangliocytes, they are actually resembling, their structure is very much resembling. So what happens is that when the antibodies, they attack the sialic acid, the same time they are attacking these gangliocytes. And when they attack these gangliocytes, can actually lead to this neurological disorders, and it can eventually paralyze the whole body. So what happens is usually the weakness start in the lower part of the body. There is muscle weakness set in both sides of the body, making it difficult to climb stairs or walk. Secondly, the hands and the feet, they begin to have a tingling sensation. And in the extreme condition, or within weeks, the respiratory system that could become paralyzed, which can ultimately lead to the death of the patient. So this is all about the campylobacteriosis and the Campylobacter jejuni. So if you like the video, please subscribe to my channel, hit the like button, and share it with your